Coaches, welcome to the final online coaching clinic for Wyndham Basketball. Coming to you from Wyndham Basketball's office with the great man, Brendan Joyce. Sitting very close. I don't know if we're social distancing, but we'll make sure we space out after we started off. But really excited to have Coach on. Obviously, his resume and record speaks for itself, without doubt. One of Australia's most renowned and successful coaches, 400 plus games in the NBL, an NBL championship with Illawarra, the Opals, Boomers, you name it, he's done it, and he's still going, and he's still got a lot to offer, and we're going to learn a lot tonight. Coach is going to talk about his style of play, focusing on some conceptual motion concepts, and also his pressure and pack defensive principles. So great presentation coming up. Thanks for tuning in. And with no more, I'll hand over to you, Coach.
Yeah, thanks, Reece, and welcome, everybody. I'm going to get up the PowerPoint right now, and so we can share it and I can talk to that. So you can just take a moment. Yeah, so everybody asks a question, especially when you're coaching at a higher level, whether you're being rep. It's probably different domestically. We all coach for different reasons. Obviously, sometimes it's just for development. But most of the time, everybody wants to win. Not only the coaches, the kids. So strategically, how do you win? Now, at the higher level, I've got 8 high-performance ingredients that I think go into a plan to be successful. But I'm only going to talk about one tonight, but it's a pretty important one. It's style of play. So some of the teams of coach, you can see there on the whiteboard, is the Wollongong Hawks for a period of time, 11 years, 12 years, Gold Coast Blaze for 2 years, the Ballarat Miners, I'm in the second stint with it, been with the Boomers, and also the Opals, but not only coaching the Opals, I was in control or managing of the whole women's program, and pretty proud of that. You know, so my philosophy is obviously comes from my experience, but also I played in the NBL. For 13 years, you know, and that certainly helps with my philosophy. So I always go back and think, well, what would I want as a player? How do I feel as a player? So that really impacts on how I coach, but also the style of play that's been developed over the years. So it's not just coaching experiences. You know, I've coached kids from under 8s right up to senior players, just like everybody, male and females, coach the kids, and it's all impacted along the way. But what I'd like to do is probably share a couple of things with you before we get right into it and just have a look at a couple of videos to get us going.
Because it's a 3-point buffer, Townsville need a prayer to force overtime. They go to the clutch man, Robert Rose, reaching in, Charles Thomas has stopped him, and Wollongong have prevailed. The Wollongong Hawks, a franchise foundation member after 23 years of championship behind the coach of the year, Brendan Joyce.
Shake the ground, you have me. Snakes tonight. Bouncing like a butterfly, singing like a bee, I heard the skies. I went from the echo to my own hero. Mitchell puts up a three. Race, here we go.
Well, that gets us going a little bit, and there's some highlights. And as you're probably aware, many of you are coaches, there's more failures than success, and there are probably a couple of high points in my career. But I've played under some great coaches. Going back to where did my philosophy come from, just to touch on that before we talk a little bit more about style of play. As mentioned, playing in the NBL for 13 years and the Victorian Basketball Association for 14 years. Play with some great players, you learn from your teammates. And, you know, I just want to acknowledge some of the great coaches that I played under and trained under certainly have impacted on my philosophy. I think about Barry Barnes, Colin Cadee, Adrian Hurley, Brian Curl, Lindsay Gase, Ian Laurie, South Australian, all the other guys are Victorians, although Curley probably says he's a Queenslander. And been real fortunate to meet so many great coaches from other countries. You know, when you're one of the great things, you don't make a lot of money really, although they're making a bit of money these days, but I guess coaching wise, we pretty much coached Australia for free, realistically, especially the Boomers, during those those two Olympics for the 8 years. But, you know, that gave me the opportunity to meet people like Tex Winners, Tim Floyd, Larry Brown, Greg Popovich, Rick Carlisle, Bobby Knight, Dean Smith, Brett Brown, Brian Gorgian, attending their clinics or have sat with them and had discussions with them. You learn from all these people. That's a privilege from my point of view that I've been able to, through my coaching, to meet those types of people. But let's talk about the style of play, and we'll show some clips a little bit later on. But the important thing for me is to play with pace. All the teams I've coached, I want to run. and I want to be able to flow into offense. There's a time and place, obviously, to run set plays. I like to run set plays and stoppages if we do run set plays. But I like to flow in what's called conceptual motion. Some people will look at this and go and say, oh, Chucks runs flow. I've heard that before, because there are some things that are similar. But I think there's a bit more involved, because we use motion. I use motion concepts. And anyone who's around knows, you know, Pete Newell, I think it was, Bobby Knight, I think it was Hank Iver, actually invented motion. And when they invented it, obviously that involved a lot of concepts, down screens, back screens, cutting, flaring, dribbling. But back then the shot clock was around 45 seconds. And so ball movement could go to that 45 seconds. You could basically get 8-10 ball reversals. So if you lapsed in concentration, you get scored upon. Then when I started coaching, we had a 30-second shot clock. It was amazing the difference in the game when it went from 30 seconds to 24 seconds. It's basically a whole ball reversal lost. And I think one of the reasons why at Wollongong we were successful is we made the adjustment from the 30 seconds to the 24 seconds. Taking out that full ball reversal means you've got to get to the point. Brett Brown would say it all the time when we're in team meetings, we've got to get to the point of how we're going to score. Now, could it be the first side, second side, third side, which I'll talk a little bit more. But for me, the style of play, I want the teams to run as long as we can, obviously under control, but with tempo control. I want my players to be versatile. I like players, and the Europeans, I think, have been the leaders of this. The Europeans have had players play multiple positions for such a long time. It's taken a while for us, the Aussies, to get there. Now we have Ben Simmons, 6'10", unbelievable point guard that can play 1-4. You know, I remember writing a report for the Boomers after the Olympics saying, we need bigger guards, we need bigger point guards, we need bigger twos. You looked at Lithuania, their players are all big and can play multiple positions, Serbia. So with that, that also allows you to be versatile with how you play from a team point of view, provided you play that way. The other thing is too, many, many years ago when the shot clock was longer, there was what we call false motion. So ball was moved around just for the sake of moving it around. And then all of a sudden, and that still occurs today. You'll see some offenses today, the ball's just moved for the sake of moving it. And then all of a sudden you'll get hit with an on ball or a down screen. I like to try and be aggressive the whole time of the shot clock. I like players to be aware and read a situation to see if they can score. And we'll show some video of that. From a defensive point of view, and I know my friend Sinisa Markovic from Serbia has been a great teacher of the game. We're on the same page. We love aggressive defense. You know, these days, obviously everyone's teaching pack, and that's not a bad thing. That's a good thing, because if you're playing against teams that can dominate you with penetration. But what if you're the better team? What if you're the aggressor? What if you've got the ability to play pressure defense and force turnovers? So the difference is, when you play pressure defense, the help comes away from two passes away rather than one, whereas pack 4 feet in the paint. So I say use both. Teach both. Let's move a little bit forward to the next slide. So the modern day offense concepts, I call it conceptual motion. The critical thing is these days is understanding the 24-second shot clock. Now, I know in juniors, I'm a director of coaching in the Ballarat Miners. Reece is here. There's a 24 shot clock starts when they get over half court. But let me tell you, how many times does that 24 shot clock ever get used? The kids are scoring usually in the first 10 or 15 seconds. The challenge for us coaching juniors is actually to get them to reverse the ball rather than score in the first 8 seconds. But if you can score in the first 4 to 6 seconds, and we did this, we found out strategically it's the best time to score. If a team doesn't have good defensive transition schemes, you can take advantage of it. You're going to get a layup, you could get a rim run, you could get a post up, and we'll show you that, or a quick on ball. So if the team isn't conditioned to play good defensive transition, your percentages go way up to score, usually above 50%. But then you have to have the ability. You have to have the ability to play with poise and go through a process to score in ball reversal. And that means to the second side, and that's usually 8 to 14 seconds, could be 6 to 14, depending on how quick your team is. And then the third side, you know, teams that play really good defense, they're going to push you to the third side. So you need to look at the score all the way through this, and you need to be playing under control. And then there's the late clock, part of that third side, the last 6 seconds. What are you going to do? Well, now the situation is, you know, whose ball, whose hands is the ball in? Is it in the right hands? Or the players that you've conditioned out there, can they make a play? Can they go off the dribble? Can they make a pass? Can they play off an on ball? They're the sort of things. Or have you got a good post player? So the schemes I'm talking about in conceptual motion are, so you're pushing the basketball. You want to be flowing is try and get a fast break. 2-on-1, 3-on-2, 4-on-3, 5-on-4. All quickly making those decisions on the run. If you're not, then can you cut to the rim and score? Have you got a quick post action? If someone dribbles it, have you trained your team to dribble drive? Do they know where to move off the dribble? Do they understand how to execute an on-ball screen? Not only between the two players, the players off the ball. What action do you want, or do you want them spaced? Or is it a dribble handoff situation? Gets, flips. You know, again, we don't expect all junior teams to have this, but when I've coached teams at the highest level and you've got them for a period of time, this is what's being taught. You can isolate through conceptual motion. If you spot a mismatch, and I don't need, you know, we don't need to go look at the computer the next day. You've got to be able to see the mismatch while it's happening. The substitution made. If there's a small player coming in going on to one of our bigger players, can we post them up? So we want that flexibility. So that's from an offensive point of view. So modern day defense, then you have to be able to defend all those situations at the highest level. Now going back to juniors, we don't have to run all this. And you know, the clubs I've been involved with, and a friend of mine, Sinister, we were at Sandringham, now I'm at Ballarat. We don't teach everything. We just teach little pieces along the way. Under 12 is real simple. Get out of each other's way. Get to the rim, pass the ball in a 2-on-1 situation, pass and cut or drive and move. That's about it. Under 14s, then you start teaching a couple of things. You know, you can teach the on-ball screen. You can pass, teach a cut and post, a little post action. And if they're denied, kids have got to know what to do if they're denied. They've got to be able to back cut. And you need movement off that. So you develop these schemes as you move up the chain. At Sandringham, we went from four teams in VC to eight after 15 months of putting this in. And our under 18 boys, Matt Nunn, he ran probably, by the time he got the under 18s, he was running six concepts. And they beat Melbourne Tigers in the under 18s who were undefeated for a year and a half. So it's not just about coaching at the highest level, it's about helping other coaches. We get pleasure out of helping other coaches get better and execute this type of stuff. So the modern day defense, again, let me just talk about Pat. Nothing wrong with it. Fan of it in the right situation. We always prepared, like playing against the USA, we thought we may have to play pack defense because of their ability. I'm talking about the Opals here, or it doesn't matter whether it's the Opals or the Boomers. The quickness of those players, the ability to penetrate so quickly, you need to clog up the lane. And what we found even back in Athens, the USA finished third. And they were having real trouble getting lots of charge fouls. Dwayne Wade, LeBron James, they were young. Allen Iverson, they were just trying to drive every time when we had it packed in. And we got away with it because, and most teams did. Lithuania beat them. You know, they ended up winning a bronze medal, but I think it was Italy that beat them. They beat them through packed defense because they're used to playing with space in the NBA. And they really found it hard to get into the lane. So in that situation, but if you're the aggressor, you can force turnovers, get on the front foot, pressure the basketball, deny the first pass, stretch the defense, force turnovers. You're vulnerable to getting beat off the dribble, but what we're saying is we're the aggressor. We're talented. I found coaching the Opals at the World Championships, we played aggressive defense all the time, which we'll have a look at a few clips. And again, you're playing against the better teams. They don't turn the ball over. They're going to use the ball. They're going to make you play defense on the second side. They're going to make you play defense on the third side. And then you better be good at defending the late clock. Is it a switch? Is it a double switch? You know, I mean, these are things we're talking as elite coaches. But you've got to understand the shot clock. And for me, the big part with defense is about disrupting. So always throwing some challenges, different ways to defend the on-ball screen. Make sure you've got great defensive transition. There's different ways of defending that. Find what's good for your team. You know, manipulate it to your personnel. Throw in some zone. So we're going to look at a bit of video. We're going to look at some Opals pushing the basketball. One of the things that frustrated me a little bit when I took over the Opals, I heard that they won't be able to play a style of play that I wanted to play. I wanted to play fast and aggressive and attacking style with lots of on balls. Well, we changed that. And now you watch the women's basketball. I love watching women's basketball in the WNBL. You see all that now. But I can tell you at the beginning, there was, you know, statements made, I don't think they'll be able to play that way. But we went on to win a bronze medal after rebuilding the team without a lot of players. Christy Harrow, the greatest point guard, I think up there with Michelle Timms, toss of a coin. You know, Lauren Jackson, we didn't have her at the Worlds in the Olympics. Lizzie snapped her Achilles at the Worlds. We'll look at some footage. But we're going to also look at some footage. I'm going to let it roll. You just see the difference in the pace of the game with the Golden State Warriors playing against the Cleveland Cavaliers from a couple of years ago. Transition versus defensive transition. The spin, the speed is amazing. The aggression of the Opals moving the basketball second and third side. You'll see some post action. You'll see guards being posted up. You'll see action off the ball, dribble attack. So dribble drive is a component of conceptual motion on balls. And you'll see, then we'll see some clips of our defense where the Opals were playing some pressure defense. So we'll have a look at that, Reece, and see how it comes up. Just pushing the ball, confidence, Aaron Phillips. Now this is playing in Turkey, against Turkey with 20,000 fans for the bronze medal. This is the USA in the semi. We wanted to be aggressive against them. Look at the rim run. Nat Burton causes a mismatch. She's 6'6", runs like a gazelle. She's got Sue Bird posted up, gets to the free throw line because we've got quick bigs. Space on the floor. Now we've got Colo drawing a double. Kick out three on transition. I'll just let it roll without making too much comment. USA players, they'll go one on two, one on three. You better have numbers or you're going to get scored on. You need at least two defenders. Quick hit and transition. No rebounders, just everybody getting back. Different style of play. Turn the ball over, you're in trouble. No pickup of the ball here, no pressure. Free throws. Play good defense, turns into offense. Worst thing that can happen for transition deep. Watch the switching here. One, two. Incredible defense. Defense to offense. Let's have a look at a bit of the half-court game with the Opals. Just an on-ball screen there. Movement, quick penetration. Penny Taylor. Penetration for our five position player, Mariana Tolo. Quick on ball, flipping an on ball. Penetration. We weren't afraid to attack. Movement off the penetration. Post up. Small guard. Screen off the ball. Aaron Phillips. Three. Shot clock going down. Good push in transition. Movement off the ball. Multiple on balls. Reading the defense. Drive it. Movement. Cutting. Let's have a look at the defense. Help positions on the on balls. Just good poster defense. Holding her ground. Mariana Tolo. Defending cutters. Stepping in the pathway. Offensive foul. That's tough. Leilani Mitchell. This is real tough. A lot of guys won't stand to take the charge. You're working on your rotations. Now, pressure defense, full court. Probably a foul by Mariana. Gets away with it. I don't know how she got away with it in Turkey. Now, look at the shot clock here. 24 seconds. Tessa Levy picks up the ball full court. She makes Lindsay Whalen handle the ball for 18 seconds. Unfortunately, we have a breakdown, but this is just amazing defense. We're denying off the ball. This is against the USA. But we have this breakdown in the post. But what we're really looking at is the pressure from the guard. Same thing here. Aaron Phillips. We've got a plugger position. That allows us to defend top, you know, deny pressure, force turnovers. This is in the bronze medal game. 20,000 Turkish people watching the game. Girls brought it big time. Great ball pressure, Aaron Phillips. Chasing. That's an example of pressure defense. All right, so let's talk about this. And my buddy Scotty Butler, who was our video analyst, we asked him to evaluate different types of offenses and talk about who makes the decisions with these particular offenses. Is it coaches or players? Now, if you look, let's go to the extreme. A set play. Coach, we're in total control of who should shoot the basketball out of a set play. So you've made that decision running the set play. It's highly structured. It's coach centered. Then you go to the other side and street ball. And most players love street ball because they can do whatever they want. All right. And I played for all different types of coaches. I definitely love my street ball coaches. But when the pressure came and you played against talent, you needed some strategy. So where do you sit? Now, we're not saying anything is bad here. It's different eras, too, of coaching. I was brought up on shuffle and flex. They are still ran today. You'll see wrinkles to probably loosen them up. The thing is with shuffle and flex, though, those offenses, they were produced when the shot clock was a lot longer as well, similar to motion. So you need a lot of ball reversals in order to get through the execution of that. And so that's an adjustment teams have had to make running the shuffle or flex today. The only way they can get through a couple of cuts and ball reversals is for that ball to move up. Back in the day, the ball was walked up the floor. I actually hated those two offenses as a player because I was a quick guard and I was asked to get the ball up the floor. That was it, and get into the offense. These days, we say to our guards, hey, get the ball up the floor, look to attack. If there's nothing there, then get into the offense. So there's been changes there. The Princeton offense, pretty structured. Blocker and mover, the Japanese run a bit of that. They're big set screens and also down screens, flare screens. You know, the Pete Newell motion or the Knight Newell motion, read and react, dribble drive, they're all probably moving towards player-centered. The boomers flow and the Opals conceptual motion, or should be just conceptual motion. So I think it's more player-driven, not completely. Coach still has a role there, but it's more player-centered to allow players to make decisions. Now, the advantages of concept-based offenses. So it teaches players to make plays and make decisions, execute skills, and not be robotic in offense. I was brought up on flex and shuffle, so it was repetitive, and you're waiting for teams to break down mentally, or you would have to have a counter. So with conceptual play, you're making reads as you go. players can learn to adapt to any system. I've found players that come out of this system can go to structured offences pretty easy. Now, the other thing is too, it's individual skill versus team offensive trade-off. So you're letting your players make some plays. I heard Rick Carlisle 2 years ago in a summer league say, I'm getting into now players making plays instead of coach calling plays all the time. So you need smart players, obviously, with an IQ to make those decisions, but it's up to us to develop their skills, but also teach them how to play in those concepts. Now, one of the other positives about playing conceptually, it's difficult to scout. So if you've got a big that's got the ball at the top and they're ready to throw it to the wing, there's a few things they can do. If they're in pack, they can throw it non-ball, or they can throw it and cut to the post. If they're in denial, it could be a back cut handoff, or maybe they're just calling. So I've had it said to me often from some players, what play is this? What play is this? No, it's not a play. You've got to make the decision. Sure, we could go and do a, we could scout and say, hey, we want more on balls, or they're in pack, look at this. But you want to get to the point where under pressure, the players are making those decisions. Because sometimes you've got to let a crowd, they can't hear you as a coach anyway. And also, they just need to be able to react according to how the defense is played. It's difficult to scout. I think the biggest compliment, and I think Ori Chiswick's reminded me, she's listening tonight, she reminded me last week, the biggest compliment we got, and I think I've ever had coaching this offense, was from Gino Ariano. We lost that, the qualifying round. So we had to play for a bronze. They played Spain. And he came up to us and he said, coaches, don't be too down. He goes, that's the toughest scout I've had in 8 years. He goes, I didn't know who was going to score. I didn't know how he was going to score. I said, I knew there were some options. But he said that was the toughest scout he's had in 8 years. So, you know, I think that's a compliment. And that's the versatility. We lost Liz Cambridge before the World Championships 1 week out. Most of our post-up action was obviously with Liz. So then we returned to our guards, like Penny Taylor and Rachel Jerry. They were tall guards. Mariano was more of a face-up player than a post-up player. You know, Berto, Nat Burton, she was our best defender. I don't see her at the Opals now, but her ability to defend on switches and defend guards and run the floor, she was our best big as a defender. Now, she scored by just rolling to the rim, scored, but that was her role. So the players understood their roles, but, you know, then we had a situation where our bigs could all shoot threes, so we were comfortable with that. So this allows you to be versatile. It also enhances the strengths where you want to, and you can attack your opponent's weakness through mismatches. As we said, Penny Taylor and Rachel Jerry. Rachel Jerry, I think it was against Belarus, she had 16 free throws. Now, she got those mainly from posting up the guard, and we also identified their best offensive player was their worst defensive player. So we talked to Rachel before the game. We said, you got the green light. So when you get the ball, wherever it is, second or third side, look to take her off the dribble. She had 2 fouls in the first 3 or 4 minutes, came back in the game and went straight. Rachel finished the game with 19 points. 16 of those were free throws. So anyway, same offense against the zone. You just have to make a few adjustments, especially if you're coming down and you dive your bigs. You know, on balls, depending on whether you've got a loaded side, is effective against the zone because you can roll and lift. But it can be your primary offense at a top level. And as I said, there's international teams that play this way. If you look at Spain, the way they play, if you look at teams like that, they're running concepts. Now, you look at San Antonio Spurs, and I know Brett, talk about coaches I've been involved with, you know, great coach, Gorgian, Tex Winners, Pete Neal, I mentioned them before, I think Dean Smith, they've all helped me in regard to my thought process about how to coach the game. I wish I knew this much when I played. Anyway, challenges. You need to teach and you need to develop players' skill packages. So you have to develop the skills of the player, obviously, to execute the concepts. And then you have to teach them to obviously playing those concepts, which then creates decision making. A lot of 1-on-1, 2-on-2, 3-on-3, 4-on-4. So breakdowns, put them in situations, a loaded side or a single side. Single side means one player on the wing to me. Loaded side could mean one player on the wing, player on the post, and a player at the top, or it could mean two players, one in the corner, one on the wing, and one at the top. So you just, what I do a lot of the time is play a lot of three-on-three to develop decision-making. I'll also give the offense an advantage sometimes. Sometimes I give them a disadvantage to develop their decision-making. So the other challenge with this is for you as a coach, you relinquish a little bit of control. You don't have to relinquish all the control. You can still decide, you know, depending on if you think your players' IQs aren't high enough or they're not ready, you can tell them what you want them to do. But eventually you'd hope that you teach them the skills and teach them the concepts that they can start making those decisions. And players love it. After a while, they love it. And it can be scary for us as coaches because we're giving up more control. And what I found is when you get players out of highly structured offenses that, like I was brought up on a little bit, shuffle and flex, or just being in a set play, just conditioned to play that way, they have a bit of trouble with it. You know, they really have a bit of trouble because they, anytime the ball is reversed, they want to be told what they've got to do. Hey, what play is this? What play is this? So you'll find that you'll probably get those questions and you have to keep pushing to say, well, hey, you know, depending on how we're being played, if you're denied back cut, if you're in pack, you're probably going to catch the ball. You can drive it, right? Try and get to the rim. And then we have a few little, things of what we do when we played off the dribble. If we drove baseline, we got cut off, that would trigger the 5Ds. And out of that, that would trigger a dance screen. If you drove middle, it could trigger a flare screen. So you've got screening actions in this as well. Now, you can't teach all that at once. But with the elite level, you know, I had Belinda Snell. She was a great shooter. I used to say to her, just drive it, you get yourself a down screen baseline. Drive it middle, then you know you're going to get that's a way to get a shot if you feel you've been starved of shots. So shooters want shots. So you can dictate and still develop this. And you can manipulate it to your players' strengths as well. But if you've got great personnel, obviously you can do a whole lot of stuff. So at least you're giving them choices and they can make decisions. Now, this is a scout on Brazil from the Olympics. And I've got Wade Hobbs. He was my guy doing work there. And if you look at that, there's two heat patterns there. There's one at the top on the right-hand side. There's one on the left-hand side. Now, they ran a lot of side pick and roll. And they read horns all the time. So not surprised to the heat pattern with the on ball there. And they were going right. You can see now everything was right-handed. So this is analytics today. Now, we can look at analytics and prepare, but analytics can lie. You know, there'll be a time where someone say they can't score going, they can only score going right, but they have a night out and they're scoring going left. Because if you go back and look at us play Brazil, in the first game, we're down 14 in the first quarter, thinking they can't go left. So we went back and said, let's guard them straight up. And we end up winning by 18. But it's an interesting thing to look at. And there you look at the shot charts. All right, look at Brazil's shot chart from that game. Again, all dominant scoring on the right hand. It blows me away. That's probably one of the most dominant, these are shots scored too that I've seen. So they've definitely struggled going left. You can utilize that, but again, as I said, when we got to the Olympics, this shot chart was from the Worlds. When we got to the Olympics, we were 14 down. They were making everything, left and right. Now, if you look at our shot chart, it's pretty balanced. And that means, for me, one of the things that Wade Hobbs was doing was he was trying to find out the efficiency of the offense and where we score. So when he showed me that, I was pretty happy because it goes back to, you can see we score a lot in the paint. We score from the three-point line. We did have a few pull-ups there, but what I like about that, it's versatile. You can't predict which side of the floor we're going to score on. We score on both sides. So, again, that comes back to style of play. That's about it, realistically, tonight. Any questions? Reece is going to hook it up now. I've got a playbook. Just in case I get the right questions, it might take a little while, electronic playbook to hook that up. So I'm going to stop sharing this PowerPoint. Thanks for listening.
Thanks, Brendan. Awesome stuff. There is some questions, so a variety of different ones, mate, I'll throw at you. First one, what would you recommend teaching under 12s defensively? I mean, you've worked with Sandringham and Ballarat.
Yeah.
Do you emphasize more pressure or pack, or is it still a combination? What do you sort of recommend there with under 12s?
Yeah, I think it's a combination. If you've got a really talented group and they're pretty switched on and they're aggressive, deny the lanes, because, you know, that's the age group where most turnovers occur, realistically. So if you just sit in pack, they'll be able to reverse the ball from side to side. So I think the best thing to do is teach pressure defense, realistically. But again, if you're an inferior team and you know you're playing against a talented team that's going to cut you up off the dribble, pack it in. So teach both.
Awesome. When you're recruiting or selecting your team, what's sort of, no, they've asked for the number one attribute, but yeah, what's some of the attributes you really look for in players?
Well, let's talk about, I like, you know, I'm into body types. If you're small, and I was a small player, so you better be quick and you better be smart and you better be aggressive, because the players are getting bigger. And I think back to Athens. Let's talk about the Boomers. I wrote a report. You know, there was only, I look back at that. I think that Boomers team, Shane Heal could compete. He was at the end of his career because he was so talented. Bogut was just a kid, but he competed because he was, you know, a 7-footer that ran like a deer back then. He could actually shoot the three. So he was legit. But where we lacked, when we looked at it, Shane Heal, you know, he'd have to guard a litho 6'5 point guard. They just take him in the post. You know, you look back, I'm just trying to think, you know, Argentina won the gold medal. So, you know, they all had big guards. And that they could switch defensively. So for me, you know, if you're quick and you're long, that gives you so much versatility as a coach, not only as to coach individuals to post them up, but it gives you versatility as a team to switch across the board. In saying that, you think of Paddy Mills, you've got someone like Paddy Dellavedova, you know, you want them pressuring the ball up the floor. You want them slowing down your opponent, so you put them in a half-court game. There's no point running back, I think, if you've got that type of small player that can, you know, terrify. You know, Paddy, throughout his career, especially early, was absolutely terrifying guards, bringing the ball up the floor, which would put teams into a half-court game. So, you know, quickness, we're talking about physical attributes. If you're small, you're going to have quickness. If you're long, you still need the quickness. That gives you an advantage. You can gap a little bit more with length. From a skill point of view, which is defensively, it's all about quickness. And there is technique, you know, involved. If you have poor technique, that can slow you down. But you'll get a lot of NBA players, you look at their technique and they're terrible and they're just so talented and quick. You know, Brett Brown used to say it all the time sometimes. Brian and I would get into a point your toe this way, point your toe that way. And he goes, guys, I don't care which way you get this player to point the toe. The player they're going to play against is going to blow by him. So you better gap. So, but I am a believer in teaching technique as well, because if you have technique combined with quickness, it can make you a better defensive player. So, you know, I hope that's a long answer, but, you know, if defense can be a physical thing, but also a technique thing. And offensively, obviously, you know, the best offensive players have great skills.
Awesome. Awesome. What about in that the conceptual motion? It's fairly free flowing, like you said. It's not equal opportunity as such, but how do you balance putting players in situations to be successful within that and trying to put them, like, playing for their strengths, essentially?
That's a great question. And I'm going to think of three guys right now that are three best shooters that I've coached. And one is, well, not three guys. One of them is Belinda Stell, a female. The other one's James Harvey. He's the other one. And Matt Campbell was a pretty good three-point shooter. But not being disrespectful, all three of those players, that's what they did well. They were great shooters. But if you put them in an on-ball screen situation, Reece, it was a turnover waiting to happen. Sorry. they're gonna hate me for saying that. So, you know, when you get through this conceptual motion, and Shane Heal talks about it all the time, I see him commentating, that players are trying to do things they can't do. So you have to sit down with them and go, well, you know, what in this offense, where do you think you sit and fit? So where's your role in this? So I'd say to Snelly, because, and shooters want the basketball. They'd be on edge if they didn't get shots. They'd end up taking bad shots.
Yeah.
Right, so especially halves, but you know, I remember him having a 40-point game. Snelly's gone off in games. Can't, you know, the shooters, if you put them in the right positions, they can score. Now, it's not just through penetration and catch and shoot. I would say to them, drive the basketball, and that would key a down screen, like I mentioned before, or drive the ball middle, and that would key a flare screen. So I actually got a couple of clips, I reckon. If everyone can just be patient a little bit, I can get up this playbook and show you some visuals of that, Reece. So just give us a chance to let's get rid of this PowerPoint. Yep. Hang on, I need to show there. So let's get rid of that. Hopefully we don't have to go back to that. And I'm going to share a screen. Just if everyone could just be patient here. We've got to bring in an iPad right now. Yep. All right, so now we've got to go. Oops. Sorry. So we're just bringing in another device. I've got my iPad here. It should show up in a second. Beautiful. Yeah. I should just click in. All right, now let's have a look at that. That question about, you know, how does we've got all these different things here, right? So we show clips, and I'm just going to look at this double action stuff. Sorry. Just going to find something that talks about that. Let's have a look at these actions here. So Belinda Snell is a shooter. She needs to shoot the basketball. We need her to shoot the basketball. The Japanese are quick. They're not going to let you get open. The only way you're going to get open is from some movement. So we take the defense one way and then set them up for some screening action. And if they switch, you'll probably see a last clip where they switch and we punish them on the switch with a big rolling. Let's have a look at it. That was flare action. This is playing Brazil in a friendly. We don't execute this that well. We're still learning it. You see Leilani Mitchell dribbling forward. The defense isn't very good, but she gets a free off a flare screen. This is really good action, forcing the switch. The Japanese switch a lot. So now we're going to get a mismatch. Now we recognize it. Great pass to the big.
Just run that through one more time.
Okay, you want to run it through again?
Yeah, just that. What have we done there? It came through pretty well, but I think we can see one more time.
All right, I'm just going to find it again. Trouble getting it up. So if I can't get it up. You got it? Oh, hang on, I know how to flick it. That is the one. So drive middle. Taking the defense up, setting her up. Sand down a bit. I find a way to score out of it. Now, if they don't score off the flare screen, they can come back and get a middle pick and roll. I call that double action. But right now, they're scoring off the screening action. Scotty said that's pretty. Probably heard Scotty Butler say that's pretty in the background. Yeah.
Really good. Is there anything else you want to show on that? Or?
Not really. It's just I just had it there in case I got some questions about some different things.
So there's a couple of other different questions. How do you recommend the coaches you're mentoring navigate all the information out there and choosing an offense now? Because, you know, there's the new clinic every day, and we've run a few of them. But there's a, you know, there's a new bit of information on Twitter or something like that. What do you sort of, how do you approach that to then come up with something like this? Or what do you recommend to coaches you're mentoring around choosing an offense and style of play?
Yeah, it gets back to the personnel, the IQ of the player, but also what you want to get out of it. I'm really encouraging players or coaches to try and steer away from set plays. Because I think that, you know, realistically, from, you know, play, when you find with a set play, usually players are standing around, and players most of the time hate that. But as from a coaching point of view, you know what you want to get to. You think you can score out of it. But I think a lot of it, you know, especially junior coaches, just stick with one set play. And sure, there's wrinkles like horns, but I think you're restricting their ability to develop on the way through. So, you know, it's a matter of finding what you think works for you. The thing I'll say to him, is it working?
Yeah.
Is it working? Do the players, are the players comfortable? Are you winning? Yeah, and everyone says it's not about winning. But let me tell you, if you do something well, doesn't it usually work? And if it works, usually you have some success. So I think that's because I get this thing, and I'm into development. You know that, Reece.
Yeah.
So I get this thing about, it should be about development. And teaching the kids. But if you give them an offense where they can't score, that's not helping their development.
Yeah, sure.
So, and it's keep it simple. I think, you know, again, this isn't that complicated, by the way. There's this stuff, but you build it. You don't throw everything in there at once, and then you implement when they're ready.
Yeah. Brilliant stuff, mate. There was one more around, what do you sort of see the differences in the style? Of the Opals play at the moment compared to when you coached, positive or negative? I don't know if you want to answer it, but it is a question that's come through.
Yeah, well, let me say that Sandy Brondello is a great coach.
Yeah.
And great friend of mine. So you won't get me criticising Sandy. So Sandy knows what she's doing. She'd be trying to get the girls to play with pace. She'd be focused on, you know, trying to get the ball, play to their strengths, get the ball through Liz. And she's aware of a lot of this stuff too. She runs, you know, I've seen her play. They'll come off an old ball, they'll set back screen. So a lot of it, there's a lot of similarities with it.
Yep.
But Sandy's got her own, you know, her own offense that she runs, but it's not a lot different.
Yeah. Very good, mate. That's it as far as questions of there's one more to come through. So let me have a look. Do you have a policy of no middle or no baseline? Or
Great question. Little story behind this. All right. So 2001, NBL, Hawks, we win the championship. So I used to shade the ball to the sideline. So I'm one of the gurus, the best defensive coaches in the country, along with Brian Gorgian. Then in 2002, we become the Australian coaches. We go to Spain. So we're thinking, both of us have the same philosophy. Let's send the ball to the sideline. It's about 10-0 after 3 minutes. Mark Casol's playing, he's only a kid. All those players, I'm trying to think, 2002. And Gorge is screaming at me going, Chuck, what's happening? You know, you're in charge of the defense. And I go, man, they're just too quick.
Yeah.
You know, and he goes, we're not rotating. I said, we're not rotating because they're that quick. So what we found was at the elite level, if you overplayed one way, you were done. All right? So even if we got the rotations, they had the ability to make the pass. So I actually changed my philosophy after that. And if you talk to the NBA guys, right, if you talk to guys in the NBA and even the WNBA, a lot of coaches, they'll say they don't send the ball to the middle, they don't send it to the sideline, guard your player. Sit down and guard your player, all right? And the NBA, because of the rules, as you know, the defense is stretched out, so they practice a lot of rotations. And I had guys, and I hate rotations, as we all do with coaches. That means you've got a problem, right, if you're rotating. But in the NBA, they have to practice rotating all the time because the players are so quick and there's so much space to drive. So for me, Reece, my thing is now I teach back to the basket, no middle, no baseline. But if you get beat, you've got help, right?
Yeah.
So you have to teach. You still have to help and rotate. But I've changed my philosophy. Now, if you want to trap, that's different. You know, the old North Carolina trap, you know, you just load up on the player's hip and you send them baseline. And to be honest, if you've got a player, like I had two players, I won't name them, in my NBL championship team, we called it red alert, you know, and they didn't know it was called red, but it was red alert, get ready to help. So, you know, I said, when these two players were on the floor, on the side, they were great shooters. I just said, you just push the ball to the side, try and cut it off. If not, we'll rotate. So sometimes you might have to protect your great shooter if they're not great defensively and, you know, come up with a strategy so they can stay on the floor. You're not getting killed defensively.
Brilliant. Jared Hillier, biggest takeaway from the years with the Opals from an offensive perspective? What's your biggest takeaway?
Just ask whether that's from offense from our point of view or learning from others.
Yeah, you can yell out if you want.
Yeah, our offense, shop.
Yeah. I guess we went in planning. We built this offense, you know, we put this offense together to try and be the best because the USA, as we know, are great athletes long and they switch everything. So any on ball, any screening, if you know, we were trying to score through that process, but we invited the switch. So, and we, that's what we got. It's just that they're so good and so talented, you know, across the board, they're so tough to beat. And, you know, without Liz Cambridge at the World Championships, we only lost to them by 12, the USA. I think that's the smallest margin still. Had we had her, that would have been interesting. Give me Lauren Jackson, that would have been interesting too. You know, Lauren's our greatest ever player. So, you know, the learnings was what we were doing worked. But from a learning perspective from other teams, it was really the great thing about coaching international basketball. You learn every time you look at a tape. You find something, you know.
Awesome. Couple more, Jock, if you're okay with it.
Yeah.
What are your best ways to drill those defensive habits you spoke about? What does your practice environment look like to get really good at that containment and other aspects?
Yeah, you've got to obviously do, you know, players play a one-on-one, haven't played a lot of one-on-one. You can give them some footwork and skills, one-on-zero, but there's, you know, you've got to show them obviously the techniques, and that might be one-on-zero with some drills, but then you put them in one-on-one situations, two-on-two, three-on-three, four-on-four. But then you give them, I like to do, I mentioned it before, a lot of advantage, disadvantage. So I only have, you know, three against two. So now you're practicing containing the basketball. If you get beat, you're rotating and you're creating a disadvantage. So try and create a situation where it's an advantage, disadvantage situation, because that raises the intensity and the importance of technique to another level because you're already outnumbered. You know, I do it especially on defensive transition. Those of you who have been around have seen it. It's 5 versus 2. We build it 5 versus 3. And the goal is not necessarily to stop them from scoring, but stopping layups. Because that's a key to winning, 5-4. So advantage, disadvantage, I think is the best way to go.
Yeah, brilliant. Last one, you've obviously had an extremely long coaching career, very successful. What's your, you know, a little bit of advice to aspiring or upcoming coaches that are looking to make a career out of it? Any tips or thoughts or things you've learned along the journey?
Keep an open mind, keep learning. Don't think you know it all, because we don't. I'm still learning. I'm a sponge. Anytime I go overseas, you know, again, one of the greatest things that ever happened to me is that I couldn't fly out of Dallas. I think it was 2015, and I'm at SMU, and Larry Brown says to me, "We can fly into Dallas," because he's coaching SMU. "How about you ride on our plane?" I rang my wife. She said, "I don't want you getting on a charter. That's a bad sign." Because the snow. I said, "I'm getting on it because I'm sitting next to Larry Brown." So I sat next to him for 3.5 hours. And just in our conversations, you know, I won't go completely into it. Of course, I asked him about coaching Allen Iverson. He loved him. And his players loved him. You know, what I learned was his players loved him because they performed well under him. So keep learning. And you don't have to learn everything. You mentioned it before about you get all this information. You've got to try and find what works. If you can overload players, you can paralyze them. So the simplicity of it, keep it simple. But keep an open mind and listen and learn. You know, I ran into Adrian Hurley. You know, we watched the boys. We were proud beating the USA at Marble Stadium. And the conversation I had with him was awesome for an hour.
Yep.
That man still got it.
Yeah,
you know, he's 80 years old. I don't know. Hope you're not, he might be 80, Adrian, but let me tell you, he's still got it. He could still coach if he wanted to.
Yeah.
So don't think as these guys get older, if you look at the Europeans, you look at the US, they've got older coaches. There's a reason, they're experienced, and they've got control of your emotions. So you'll find, you know, as you grow too as a coach, you're probably, you know, I was more emotional than what I am today, that's for sure. You know, so keep an open mind and keep an open mind to grow.
That's awesome. I might just stop you sharing and we'll wrap it up, Chuck.
Over here, isn't it?
Thanks, coaches, so much for tuning in. And obviously, thanks to the great man for jumping on. It was awesome. And he listed a lot of great coaches he's got to learn from. And I've been lucky to be able to pick Brendan's brain a number of times on various different things. And to having him here tonight, it's just an awesome experience. And for me personally, but obviously for everyone that's tuned in. And thanks to everyone for tuning in. It's been a great 3 months running these clinics as far as the engagement and the learning, but I'm looking forward to getting back on court. I'm sure everyone else is too. So thanks again, mate.
Thanks. Thanks, guys. Have a great night. Footy's on.
Yeah, good time to work.